Well, how about the church's nature? Why is it that a Christian is a Christian? What is this thing that's called the New Testament? Have any of you ever been puzzled over New Testament and Old Testament? Those are words from 1620, and they don't exist in our vocabulary today. What a testament is, it's your will. It's what you covenant. When you write down before you die what you're going to do, it's your oath. And it can't be revoked that your kids will get the money. All right. Where there's a will, there's a relative. That's just the way it is in life. And so a will is a testimony. And so the New Testament and the Old Testament are God's oath to His covenant people and His relationship that He swore Himself to His covenant people, Israel and the body of Christ, Jew and Gentile. Well, what is the Old Covenant and the New Covenant? You've heard me put it like this before, and it's a good way to put it because Paul uses this analogy. When you have a child and you raise him, you have that child under what sort of relationship? Law. You do not give the child a choice. You threaten the child. And because that's good. Because a child doesn't have the maturity to do what's right. And so you say, you will eat that broccoli. Then you tell them again, eat the broccoli. Then you use their full name. Benjamin Thomas Nelson, eat your broccoli. And you know that's when you better eat. Then you hit them with something blunt, all right, to make them do it. You say, be in at 10. You say, no, you're not going to have a mohawk. You're not going to have a green mohawk. That's a rule. When you leave here, you can do it. Right now, you're not going to have it. You have a child under law. Do you intend to keep that child under law? No. If you do, you're a bad parent. You raise the child to freedom, right? To free them. Now, in Israel, they had a point in time, a bar mitzvah, at the age of 13. In Africa, it's about the age of 12. A child is a child until 12, and they will take the boys out, and they will have a ritual where you're no longer a boy. You don't have to do what mama says. You're expected to do it because you're a man, and you're expected to be free and to gather with the tribe and to fight for the tribe. If you don't, incidentally, they kill you, so it's a good system. They don't have any delinquency in Africa among those tribes. Also, at the age of 12, that's when they circumcise you, which is a marvelous rite for a young man. That you will mature greatly when that occurs. But they have an official point. Israel had a bar mitzvah. You're a son of the law. In America, we don't have really a delineation. We probably should. I guess it's when you get your license, you're expected to be mature. We raise a child as a child, and then they become sons and daughters, and hopefully when they go away to college, they are given freedom. Hopefully before that. That you don't have to say to them, you will be in at 10:30 or whatever. They are expected to be mature and to handle freedom. Well, that's the way that God dealt with His covenant people. In the Old Testament, you had hygienic law, moral law, and ceremonial law to educate, protect, and separate the people. To keep them under a yoke because they weren't mature enough to handle it. Moses went up the mountain for a month and came back to an orgy. You couldn't give the people freedom. But Paul said, when the fullness of the time came, the bar mitzvah, Galatians 4, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And God has sent forth the Holy Spirit of His Son, crying, Abba, Father. That when you become a Christian, you're under a new covenant, not of law, but of grace, not of a child, but a son. And you have an intuitive, instinctive desire to learn of God, and to obey the Bible, and to love the brethren. How many of you have heard testimonies that went something like this? All of my life I knew what was right, but I just couldn't do it and didn't want to do it. And then I put my faith in Christ, and something changed in my heart. And I began now to have an instinct and a desire to want to obey God. You know what they were saying? That He has written on my heart the law, not on tablets of human stones, or of stones, but on tablets of human hearts. Not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. 2 Corinthians 3:3, that's the New Testament. And so Christians are under a New Testament. And let me tell you how this applies. How many of you have ever talked to a non-Christian about our faith, that it's receiving what another did for us, having a change of nature to obey Him? And they say, what are the rules? And you say, the only rule is to walk in the Spirit and to love Him. Well, do you have any prayer beads? No. Do you have any holy pilgrimages? No. Do you have any washings and fastings and all of those things you have to keep? No. Do you have any in church service? Do you have an order of worship? Rise up, sit down, kneel, fight, fight, fight. Do you know you have any of those? No, we don't have any of those. And they said to you, well, that's not much of a religion. I mean, you don't have to have any cardiovascular efficiency to be a Christian. And you said to them, I know. Do you know what that's the response of? Bless their sweet heart. That is an unregenerate, ignorant person beholding the new covenant. What is your job as a 25-year-old boy? Answer, to love my parents and do right. Well, what's that entail? Well, it's a lot of things, but basically you love your parents. It's a relationship. Everything I have comes from them. No, don't you have any rules? What's the rules of being a Christian? To love God, to love your neighbor. That's the new covenant. So we are under a new covenant.